End-to-end and UI testing are great. They ensure the application works from your user's point of view, but they also have a strong tendency to be flaky. By taking a few precautions, we can minimize this tendency. Let's talk about timeouts. In Cypress, the most common timeouts are these. Default command timeout is the time until any DOM-based action takes place, like doing a click, and it defaults just 4 seconds. Page load timeout is the time for a page transition, or when we run ci.visit or ci.go, it waits until the page fires all the load events. The default timeout is 60 seconds. The response timeout is the time until ci request, ci wait, ci fixture, or ci get cookie. Get cookies or CI screenshot, all these commands should complete in about 30 seconds by default. The exec timeout is the time it takes a system to run CI exec command, which is 60 seconds. And the task timeout is the time to wait until a CI.task runs, in by default it's 60 seconds. How do we change the defaults? To change the default, we need a cypress.config.js, and then we load the defined config object and set the timers as we wish, so it's pretty straightforward. We can also set the timeouts inside the test file by calling cypress.config, the timeout, and the number, or we can change the timeout for a given test by calling the optional argument timeout with a different value. Second, we should configure automatic retries. To configure retries, we have two options. We can configure run mode, which is the number of test retries when we run Cypress run. The default is 0, and open mode is the number of test retries when we run Cypress open. The default also is 0. To change the value, same as with timeouts, we create a cypress.config.js and use the retries key, and we can set the number of retries for the run mode and for the open mode. In this example, we have 2 retries for run mode and 1 retry for open mode. We can also configure retries attempts in a specific test in the it clause using the optional argument retries and also using run mode on open mode as options. The third way we can configure tests is in the describe block, so this retries will apply to all the tests inside the describe block. So in this case, 2 tests will run with 2 retries for run mode and 1 retry for open mode. The third tip is to use a flaky detector. We have 2 options here. If you are a Cypress premium user, there's a cloud feature that detects flaky tests. As of Cypress 13.4, this is an experimental flake detection feature, and it only works when you're running Cypress in Cypress Cloud. The second option is to enable flaky detection in your CI. If you are a semaphore user, you already have this feature built in your pipeline. You only need to configure test reports, and automatically you will get a test report with all the flaky tests in your project. The fourth tip is to avoid using hard waits. What I mean with this is when we call ci.wait and we put a time in milliseconds. Using ci wait is an anti-pattern that can lead to flaky results. The reason is that you cannot know in advance what is the right time to wait, how much time to wait, so you can wait too long and make the test slower than needed, or wait too little and fail to detect some feature in the page because the page has not finished loading. This all depends on the server and the network speed, so it's very difficult to know in advance. For example, one anti-pattern is to use CI wait in this way when we call CI request and we call some API, and then we call CI wait just to be sure that the request has fulfilled. The problem is that CI request automatically waits until there's a response from the API, so CI wait is not needed. The fifth tip is to avoid relying on conditional tests using ifs. Here's an example. You may add an if statement to check if a specific condition has been met before performing the test. The problem is that the DOM is so dynamic that you have no guarantee that by the time the test executes the chosen if branch, the page has not changed. We should only use conditional test if statements only when we are sure that the DOM is stable and there are no pending changes on the page. If you rely on the state of the DOM for conditional testing, you may end up writing a flaky test. Conditional testing, according to Cypress documentation, is the leading cause for flakiness. 6 is to debug test locally. This is to avoid checking in flaky tests into your repository and running them on your CI pipeline. One way to run locally is by executing npx cypress open. The idea is to carefully inspect all the tests locally, especially the new ones, before committing them into your repository. Running Cypress open the Cypress app. On the left-hand side, the application contains the command log, a column where each of the test block is shown. The Cypress app will show all the commands executed within it, as well as any commands executed in the before each, and after each hook. On the right side, there's the application under test, running in the selected browser. In this section, we have access to the developer tools of the browser. Since the flaky test may or may not fail, you should run each test locally more than once. When a test fails, Cypress will produce a detailed error, showing the error name, the error message, and links to relevant documentation. We get the file that produces the error, the line, and we can click on them to open the integrated IDE. One thing we may want to enable is logging, and we can do that on the browser by running local storage debug equals cypress semicolon asterisk. This will enable all event logins in the browser. Then in the browser, we can enable verbose mode and reload the page. Now when running a test, we will see all the Cypress event logs in the browser's console. When we find a problem in one of our tests, we can call the debug method on the instruction that creates the error. This defines a debugging breakpoint by pausing the test executions, logs the current state in the console, and enables the JavaScript debugger instruction. You need to have the developer's tools open so the breakpoint activates and you can see the state of the application. Instead of using debug, you can also call CI pause. This will programmatically pause the test and give you time to use the developer tools in the browser to inspect the application state. Note that pause can also be chained off with other CI methods, so you can resume execution using the play button in the command log. If you don't want to do this manual work, you can also run npx cypress run. This will run the test without pausing, and it will automatically capture screenshots when a failure happens. If this is not enough for debugging, you can also take a manual screenshot by calling ci.screenshot instruction. You can enable video recordings if you want to run the test without manual interaction. When you run Cypress Run, if you enable the video option, Cypress will record videos on successful and failed tests. The only downside is the space that the video takes in your machine, and this feature only works on Chromium-based browsers. My last tip is to mind the way you select elements in your page. As a best practice to avoid flakiness, the Cypress documentation recommends writing selectors that are resilient to changes. There are three things to keep in mind. Do not target elements based on the HTML tag or CSS attributes like ID or class. Try to avoid targeting elements based on their content, the text, and add custom data attributes into the HTML in your application to make it easier to target them. So consider this HTML snippet for a button. We should never use CI_GET_button or CI_GET_button_button_primary because they are too generic and coupled with styling, which can change very frequently. We can use CI_GET_subscribe or CI_GET_name=subscription or CI.containsSubscribe, but we should use it sparingly because they are still coupled with styling, with JavaScript event listeners, or coupled with the name attribute, which has HTML semantics. The best option is to use CI.getDataCI=subscribe button. This was an element explicitly created for testing, and it will not change even if we change the styling or the contents of the button. That's all for today. I hope these tips help you write more stable tests. If you like this video, please like, subscribe, and follow us so you don't miss the next one. Thank you for watching, and see you in the next one.